Welcome back to Mass Appeal, everybody. Do you know how you can take your Thanksgiving cooking to the next level?
How?
Make your own oven mitt. Duh.
Duh. Give it as a gift, too. We're here with Tess Poe, owner of Beehive Sewing in Northampton, and you're going to show us how to make our very own oven mitt.
I am. This is great. This is in keeping with our holiday traditions. So we have your pop quiz, your sewing pop quiz.
Oh, no.
Tell me, Seth Stutman, what separates you from the apes?
Opposable thumbs.
Opposable thumbs. So a lot of oven mitts you see kind of just look like this.
Yeah.
Not nearly as functional as ones that have a movable thumb.
And you can make a sock puppet out of it,
and
too.
And you can make a sock puppet. So we are going to make an oven mitt that has a movable thumb, a lot more functional, a lot more fun, just a little bit different from your regular oven mitt, but kind of goes the distance.
Is it really difficult
Makes
to
sense.
Make this?
It is not at all difficult to make this. So two skills that you're going to learn when you make your oven mitt. The first is going to be quilting. How do you quilt fabric together? The second's gonna be sewing around curves. So let's talk just for a sec about what our oven mitt is made of. This is just cotton fabric made from a local designer. I have quilted it with muslin on the back. All that means is that I've stitched through two layers of fabric and I've put some soft batting in between. And that's what's gonna keep it nice and cool when you're taking your stuffing out of the oven.
That's all the stuffing you need to take your stuffing out of the oven.
Right, that's all the stuffing you need in your quilting to take your stuffing from the oven. So, what you'll see on the machine is we've got a little sample here, and it's gonna be this easy. We just did straight line quilting. Notice that we have a crazy presser foot on the machine. This is called a walking foot. If you have one at home, it'll make your life a million times easier. If you don't, that's okay.
So What's the purpose of a walking foot?
The purpose of a walking foot is to give you some extra teeth that help to grip the fabric on the top so that as you're doing this quilting, you end up with a little bit more stability.
Uh-oh.
So let's just take your work out of the machine and show everyone what you did.
Nice job.
You didn't do all of that. I did some of that. But you can quilt that. What we're going to do for our pot holder is use pre-quilted fabric. And I reused a pillowcase that already had a quilting design on it.
So if this was too difficult for you, this one is the way to go.
I was like, how did you get that fancy pattern? I'm not gonna do squiggles on a sewing machine. Right. I can't even do a straight line.
But guess what? I did this one out of an old pair of jeans and I just did some straight line quilting on here.
A denim oven mitt? Best gift ever.
Cool, right? So if we're gonna use our reused pillowcase, we're just gonna cut our pattern pieces and you'll see that in order for us to have our opposable thumbs, we have three pieces. Instead of two pieces that look like a hand, we're gonna have three pieces.
And these pieces are also documented right here.
Right, we've got them on butcher paper so we can trace our patterns with a Sharpie, cut out our fabric, and then we are just gonna do, this is really just two seams, that's it. So now your challenge is to sew around curves. Sewing around
curves. My challenge?
Well, we could switch spots and I could sew around curves.
I'm gonna go with yes, please.
As long as I can stay right here.
Switcheroo.
So sewing around curves can be a little bit tricky for folks. The thing to remember is to take your time. Take your time and maybe think about using a shorter stitch length if you can. I'm gonna keep this walking foot on here, but you can certainly just use a regular presser foot. What I've done on our fabric is I have drawn a stitching line to help me go around those curves.
That's fine.
You don't have to use the, you know, the markings on the machine. There's no shame in drawing stitching lines on your work.
An example of how to go fast, right?
That was an example of how to go fast.
Okay.
So you end up with this. I'm gonna take out my pins and you'll see that if I flip this over, I now, this is my thumb.
This is my thumb area. Oh, and this is the other side?
And that's the other side. So we're just going to go right sides together, and we're going to stitch all around here. Now, just before I do that, I want to show you another tool. You guys have used this before here. Do you remember what these are?
Pinking shears.
Pinking shears.
I knew it. I said it right there.
I did. I wrote it right on the blade here.
Thank you.
Our pinking shears are going to help us reduce some of the bulk, especially if you have quilted the fabric on your own.
Now, why pinking? That's to keep it from fraying, right?
Yep. So what you'll see is these pinking shears give these little notches right here across the top of the fabric. So that's a big help when we're working with many layers of something, something that's gonna be turned. You want it to be comfortable. So we're gonna pretend that I've pinked all around here.
Okay.
And then you sew.
We're just gonna do right sides together again. And this pattern that I have skews a little bit on the larger side. So you can absolutely, if you're making this for a child or someone who's got smaller hands, it's fine if you wanna just
scale it down a little.
Scale it down just a little bit.
Well, Tess, while you're doing that, why don't we tell everybody at home who People Magazine revealed as their pick.